Hi guys, I'm Ben from Adaptalux, and today we're talking about UV photography, specifically UV-induced visible fluorescence photography, or UVIVF. Now it's really, really interesting, so today we're going to break down what it is and how to do it. So today's video we're actually going to split into two parts. The first part, we're going to be talking about what UV photography actually is and what visible fluorescence is. The second part, which I'll link up on the top of the screen now in case you just want to skip to the how-to, I'll also put it in the description, we'll be talking about exactly how to do it. So we'll be going through a setup and showing you how to get shots like the ones that you've just seen. You've probably heard of UV photography before, but what you might not realise is that there's actually two completely different types that go underneath that banner of UV photography. We'll be taking a look at both of them because it's important to understand the differences. They require completely different techniques and equipment, and if you're talking about UV photography to somebody, they could have a completely different image in their head of what you're talking about. So let's break down the differences between the two different types. The first type is reflected UV photography. So the way that this works is that you need a full spectrum light source, like the sun or a modified flash, that produces UV light. You can then shine this at a subject, for example a person, and the light will be reflected back into the camera like it normally would be. The difference then is that you put a filter in front of the camera to block out all of the visible light, and you modify your camera so that it's able to capture only the UV light. This is why when you see reflected UV images, they're always in black and white, because there's no colours there to capture. Now, this isn't the type that we're going to be talking about today, but it's important to make that distinction that this type of photography requires camera modifications and a different set of equipment to capture than the induced visible fluorescence UV photography that we're going to be looking at today. Ultraviolet induced visible fluorescence photography. It's a bit of a mouthful, but it's important to understand the differences between this style and the reflected style. The difference here is that we're still capturing visible light. We're just using UV light in order to create the visible light. I can give you a quick demo here using tonic water, which actually fluoresces really well under UV light. But you might be thinking, why do things like tonic water actually glow under UV light? To understand that, we're going to need to take a look at the electromagnetic spectrum. You probably remember this from science class in school. What we're essentially looking at here is everything from gamma rays through to radio waves. It's all classed as a form of radiation, including visible light. Visible light is the bit that we're interested in photography most of the time. But when you get to the fringes of what our eyes can actually see, it starts to blur the lines a little bit, and some cameras can see infrared and UV as well, and people make specialist cameras that go even further than that. That's exactly what an X-ray is in the hospital if you've ever broken your leg or something like that. So it's much easier to think about all of this as a single form of radiation. It's not visible light versus UV light. It's a very similar thing. The only difference is that the wavelength of UV light is a little bit shorter than that of blue or violet, its nearest visible neighbours. Fluorescence is actually caused by a shift in that wavelength as light is absorbed into a material or object and then it's re-emitted again. The reason for this is because when an energetic photon hits an object, it's going to be absorbed and then it's going to get emitted again. Now, this process of light being absorbed and then re-emitted is not perfectly efficient, so a little bit of energy is lost there. So when you look at UV light, which is more energetic than visible light, that gets absorbed into objects pretty regularly. And depending on the chemical makeup of the object, a certain amount of energy is lost. Now, that energy that is lost is the difference between the UV light and then the color that is produced by that particular chemical when exposed to UV light. So certain objects will show up as different colours. Our tonic water shows up as blue because of the quinine inside of it. And if you then go and look at highlighter pens and certain types of plastics, those are specifically designed with chemicals inside them that glow a certain colour under light and UV light. So there's your faux science-y, very quick explanation to what UV fluorescence actually is. But what does that mean for photography? It essentially means that we can expose objects to UV light and they will glow in the visible spectrum, which is what our cameras tend to be able to capture. So this means that we don't need any modifications or extra filters to our actual camera. Because we're just capturing, admittedly, quite low levels of visible light. We can take a quick look at one of the pictures that we've taken using UVIVF techniques. This is a shot of a garden spider. It's brown and it's creepy and I hate it, but we decided to go out into the garden and take this shot. And you can see that when exposed to UV light, different parts of the spider are actually different colours, and now this is because of the chemical makeup in the spider is actually it's different in certain places, and there's lots of reasons for this, including like the spider wants to be seen to have eyes on its back and things like this to get rid of predators. But you'll see that the eyes are showing up red, the head is red, and it's just the different chemical makeup within the spider itself that's causing this. And this can be seen in a lot of different objects and subjects that we can find around the place. Most things, especially living things, will have a certain amount of fluorescence capability. You can shine UV onto a lot of plants, petals, and particularly pollen. They all glow really, really well under UV light. You've also no doubt seen a lot of images and maybe even video where people have been supplementing their UV photography using highly fluorescent chemicals and materials, things like paints and dusts. You can use those to create some really interesting effects. It's almost a subsect of UVIVF photography in itself, because those materials are so fluorescent, you don't need to practice a lot of the techniques that we'll be looking at in a little while. As primarily a macro photographer, the part of UV fluorescence photography that I'm interested in is actually the purity. So what do I mean by that? A lot of these black lights and cheaper UV light sources that you find around the place in sort of LED torches and fluorescent bulbs and things like this, they produce a lot of visible light as well as UV. So this will be fine for highly fluorescent materials like the quinine in our tonic water. That will glow even if there's visible light there as well, because the UV will manage to overpower it. When we're talking about taking fluorescence photographs of, say, flowers or insects like our spider, there's a big consideration there that even the smallest amount of visible light will actually overpower the fluorescence of the subject. And you'll be able to identify this as a blue, purpley, violet hue over your images if you're using a less than perfect light source. How do we get a pure UV light source? It's probably the first hurdle that you're going to come up against when you start thinking about UV fluorescence photography. It's certainly one of the most important factors, because if your light source is introducing visible light as well as UV, then that visible light is going to easily overpower the fluorescence of the subject that you're shooting. We've got a couple of ways around this though, using different types of equipment. Before I mention that though, we need to talk about eye protection. UV light can be harmful to your eyes, either over an extended period of time or in short bursts of intensity. Either way, you're going to want to reduce the amount of UV light that reaches your eyes. My glasses have a UV coating on them, which is pretty handy, but you guys are going to need some eye protection as well. You can get UV protective glasses for a couple of pounds, a couple of dollars online, and if all else fails, you can wear your sunglasses, because that's exactly what they're designed for, is cutting out UV light from the sun, so those will work just fine. Now the equipment that I'm going to be using today is the Adaptalux Studio with our UV lighting arms, which you'll notice have a little purple end here, and there's a couple of other more interesting details as well, differences to our normal lighting arms. You'll see that I've just plugged this in here and there's nothing happened, and that's because the only light passing out of the end of this lighting arm is UV, and that's by design, that's because it's a pure UV light source. There's a UV LED in the end of here, but that still creates a little bit of visible light, the same as it would if you found it in an LED torch, for example, a UV LED torch. The difference here is that we then have a bandpass filter in the end as well. Now this, to our eyes, looks completely black because there's no visible light allowed to pass through this filter at all. So it's blocking out all of the visible light and only allowing UV to pass through, which is exactly what we need for a pure UV light source. Our other option, if you need a little bit more intensity maybe, it still comes with a bit some caveats, but you can use a flash. Now there's plenty of tutorials out on YouTube and on various blogs and things on how to take apart speed lights and fit them for pure UV fluorescence photography. I'm not going to go into the details of taking apart a flash and how to do that, because I've got the Adaptalux Studio to use, but you can absolutely do that as an option. I would just caution you that you definitely need to know what you're doing before you start taking apart your speed lights. They do run very high voltage circuits, even though they're very small and only run on batteries. They store up a lot of power and they can be quite dangerous. So definitely do your research and make sure you know what you're doing before you go meddling with your speed lights. So I've come into my bathroom. Why? Well, it's because this is the darkest room in my house, and you're going to need to start eliminating some ambient visible light. What's the point in having a pure UV light source if you've got visible light everywhere else? It's just going to contaminate your shot in the same way. So you need a dark environment. I recommend finding the darkest room in your house, maybe blocking up some windows, close the curtains and things like that, or shoot at night time. Because any amount of visible ambient light at all is going to contaminate and potentially overpower the fluorescence from your subject. Most subjects, particularly when you're talking about, say, flowers and insects, they don't fluoresce as much as the quinine in our tonic water or those fluorescent dyes and things that you see. So you need to do a long exposure to capture what little visible light is actually produced by these subjects. The subject that I'm going to be shooting in the next video for UV fluorescence is flowers, lilies to be precise. Now there's lots of flowers and plants and things that fluoresce really, really nicely. It is a little bit of a case of experimenting, grabbing things from around your garden and putting them under the UV light, taking an exposure, see what it does. Lilies actually produce a fair amount. They're not the best, but enough. The reason that I'm shooting them today is because they're pretty common and they have a lot of interesting colours that are going to show up in our UV photographs, including all of this pollen around here. I'm pretty sure that's going to fluoresce blue, while the rest of the leaf will either maintain its colour or have a slightly different hue. So it's going to be really interesting to see what happens with this when we put it under some UV light and take a long exposure. And that's exactly what we're going to be doing in just a sec in the next video. I'll link it at the end of this one, I'll link it in the description, and I'll see you there in just a sec.